an esteemed teacher and guide. We are truly honored to have you today with us, sir. He will be talking on modifications to make trabeculectomy safer and more effective.
Hello. Yeah, very good morning. It's a great honor and my privilege to be here with you. and also I am grateful to AIOC to allow me to say something informed of you. Actually, today I am going to share my experience in modification of technique of trabeculectomy to build a safer surgical procedure. You know, glaucoma is the second leading cause of blindness. More than 50 million people are affected in the world, and over the 40 years of ages, 1 in 40 adults are suffering from these diseases. I am working in Isfahani Islami Eye Institute Hospital in Bangladesh, which is one of the oldest and largest eye care specialty hospital in our country. And there was a study in 2018 to 2019. We have seen nearly 280,000 patients in last year, and out of those patients, 23,000 patients was glaucoma patient. And out of the glaucoma patient, angle closure was more, which was nearly 43%, but open angle glaucoma was nearly 25%. So in our country, angle closure is more common than primary open angle glaucoma. You know, trabeculectomy is the still now gold standard glaucoma filtration surgery, and its success rate up to 100% in experienced hand. But for this, you need to modify its technique, you need to use different types of anti-metabolites during the surgical procedure, and you have to use releasable scissor, then you will get a successful trabeculectomy. All you know, trabeculectomy is a very simple surgery. Just you need to make a hole, but be very careful. Don't fall into that hole, because it has lots of devastating complications. First thing is anesthesia. There are different types of anesthesia you are using in trabeculectomy. We are commonly using perivalvar anesthesia. You know, it will give a good anesthesia, but it has few complications. You can also use subtenons anesthesia during trabeculectomy, and it also gives good anesthesia, and it has less complication than perivalvar anesthesia. You can also topical anesthesia, but patient may feel few pain or discomfort during the procedure. But problem is that if patient vision is normal but very advanced glaucoma, poor visual threshold or only central island of vision, then what types of anesthesia you are prefer? Mostly I prefer subtenous anesthesia in advanced glaucoma, because wipeout syndrome or post surgical vision loss is less common in subtenous anesthesia than perivalvar anesthesia. It is a very simple technique by which that's why I want to use my laptop. Can I use my laptop? Yeah, I have laptop here. Yeah. Huh. By very simple way, you can give the subtenous anesthesia. Just you need to dissect conjunctiva, then using a blunt gel cannula, you can inject it subtenous space. So it is very simple technique, and by this way you can do trabeculectomy in a better way. Next important thing is the antifibrotic. There are different types of antifibrotic we are using. The most commonly antifibrotic is mitomycin C that we are commonly practicing. Another neuroanin collagen or collagen matrix that we are using. But the question is, which one is comparatively better and which one is more effective? You know, the mitomycin C has lots of lab-related complication than collagen matrix. I had a study by comparing the mitomycin C with collagen, which one is more effective in trabeculectomy and safer. That was published in European Journal of Ophthalmology, and there I found both are effective, but collagen is much more safer than mitomycin C, because mitomycin C has lots of bleb-related complications like thin bleb, cystic bleb, or late bleb leakage may be happened. So we can easily apply antifibrotic. Mitomycin C you can inject subconjunctivally, or after the conjunctival dissection you can implant it. But in case of collagen, after all the procedure is just placed in subconjunctival. The next important thing is the making the conjunctival flap. You know, you can make it in fornix based or limbus based. Both are effective, but technically limbus based it may hamper your further procedure, and it may produce subconjunctival scar behind the scleral flap. That's why I personally prefer fornix based flap in trabeculectomy. The next important thing is how to make a scleral flap. You can make it triangular or rectangular. Both are effective, but I personally prefer triangular flap because technically it is easier and less time consuming, and you can make it close by only single stitch after the procedure. This video showing the procedure of making scleral flap in single trabeculectomy. Though I prefer triangular flap, just I am making scleral flap in trabeculectomy. This is the procedure of making triangular flap in combined surgery in TAB-SICS. Just same things, but you need to extend it at the level of limbus to the periphery, so that you can easily deliver the lens at the same port. And you can make also close this flap only single stitch, no need to give multiple stitch. This is the procedure of making flap in trap phaco. After making triangular flap in the same manner, then I always use two separate pores for phacoemulsification. After making scleral flap, now I am doing phacoemulsification by separate port. Now you can make ostium by punch forceps or 15 degree knife. Personally, I prefer to use punch forceps because it is easy to handle, and you can make enlarge your ostium by seeing you what you need. Now, the most important thing is level of closure. At the level of closure, you can use both fixed suture or releasable suture. Some surgeons prefer only fixed suture, some surgeons prefer both. I personally prefer both types of suture in trabeculectomy. When I will do single trabeculectomy, then I only prefer one fixed suture at the apex of the triangular flap, then two releasable suture at the two sides. First time I applied fixed suture, now I am giving releasable suture. It is very easy to why to give. First needle pass through the under the conjunctiva into the cornea, then make a loop at the limbus, then four knot is applied at the site of the incision mark. Now in same manner I am applying another releasable suture at the other side of the incision. But in case of combined procedure, I always give single stitch, and if I need to apply more stitch, then I give releasable suture. But in case of phacoemulsification, I applied another stitch at the phaco side port. So So this is few post-op picture after trabeculectomy. You see reducible suture. So this type of reducible suture you can easily remove in postoperative period on outpatient department, but only seeing in slit lamp examination. So if you need proper filtration, then you need to make a good bleb. And when a patient is diffuse, mildly vascularized, elevated bleb, then you can see your IP is maintaining and patient is in good control of intraocular pressure. In case of primary angle closure glaucoma, I prefer always early surgery, because if you do early surgery is primary angle closure glaucoma, either it combined surgery or either phacoemulsification, then you will get always good control of intraocular pressure in postoperative period. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thanks a lot, sir. Many practical tips for glaucoma surgeons to make their trab more effective. Dr. J.C. Das is in the house. I would like his opinion on the same. Do we have a floating mic? Okay.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Excellent slides, excellent surgery. But I'd like to give certain comments in this sense that trabeculectomy or any other surgery in glaucoma is personalized. You must practice the surgery and the steps which is best suited to your hand. For so many years, maybe I have modified my technique not less than 20-25 times, trying all the procedures under the sun. And still I'm looking for an ideal surgery in my hand to suit all the patients. So that way one has to really find out what type of suturing has to do, what type of flap, and how much to tighten it, whether to put a releasable suture or not. And nowadays we have suture for not a releasable suture, it's an adjustable suture. Adjustable sutures. So that is very, very personalized. But the basic principles, the least cutting, least damage to the subendoral space, least dissection, and the best results. And how much application of mitomycin C in whichever area you plan has to be really personalized depending on the case you deal and the best result you get in your hand. Right? But excellent video, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. So, Dr. Bipul, I have a few questions. Do you titrate the time of MMC application, or do you use it, for the same period in all the patients?
Sorry?
Do you titrate the amount or the time of MMC? Like, do you use it for 2 minutes, 3 minutes
for all your
patients?
Yeah.
Or do you change it according to the baseline IOP?
Of course. You need to, in case of mitomycin C, you need to apply it 2 minutes, average 2 to 3 minutes, or 1.5 minutes, it depends. Some cases that are refractory to our second surgery, then you need to apply more time.
And what about ALS? Do you use a laser suturalysis in your clinic?
No, though there is option of suturalysis, but if you apply releasable suture, then you can easily remove.
Yeah.
And only one suture will be there.
Right.
But in case of combined surgery, I give one single fixed suture.
Fixed suture.
So,
don't need to remove it ever. Okay. And when do you release your releasable suture?
It depends upon the cases. So you need to see that in postoperative period, you see in after 3 day or first day or 3 day or 7 day, there is a shallow anterior chamber but AC stable, then you can keep the suture. But if you see there is a stable AC, everything is good, then you can release one suture. And another stitch you can remove after 1 week.
Right.
Usually I prefer to do remove stitch within the 2 weeks or 3 weeks.
Okay, thank you so much, sir. Do we have any question here?
Dr. Sarkar, how is experience about using 5-FU post-operatively and using intraop MMC? Which one do you find better?
Post-operatively, I prefer 5-FU, but intraoperatively...
No, I am asking that which one is better, whether using intraop MMC or post-op 5-FU?
Personally, ma'am, I don't prefer to use 5-FU. I personally use MMC or allogen implant. Olazine is little bit costly, but I found sometimes it better result than MMC because it can maintain a space within the sclera within subconjunctival space, for there are less chance of fibrosis. I have a lot of patient after Olazine application, they are still now very good control of intraocular pressure. But personally, I don't have any experience in using 5FU.
What I feel, 5FU can be used. Yeah, but in MMC intraop, when we use, there are chances of more chances of having a bleb leak as compared to post-op. If you are applying, like if you are doing a case of like moderate glaucoma, yeah. Combined surgery we have done, and we are not going to going for an intraop MMC. That's my personal experience. So I preserve MMC. I don't use MMC in that particular case, and I later on I titrate with 5FUs, and that is
what
giving
my experience is in combined surgery. One has to use MITRA because the chances of failure of combined surgery is much more than simple trabeculectomy. Yeah. You may decide not to use mitomycin C in simple trabeculectomy if you are doing a primary surgery and in a moderate. But in very advanced glaucoma, since you need pressures in early teens or in single digit, I think it is always a better idea to use mitomycin C. Uh-huh. Although what my technique is that now, like I, my goal is to facilitate the posterior flow. So I don't cut the scleral flap right up to the limbus. Yes. I just leave little bit of flap unopened on both the sides of limbus and releasable suture mostly at the apex. Or I make sclera, So I think that way you can facilitate the posterior flow and
the ring of steel can be
rings
prevented.
Of steel, I know.
Yes. So,
little bit of my comments on the adjustable sutures or even releasable sutures. Let us understand why do you put a releasable suture. Releasable sutures are of particular value when the intraocular pressure immediate postoperative is likely to be high, or you intentionally see that the pressure is not low. Say for example, a vitrectomized eye, for example, high myopes, ophthalmic eyes, where or even non-ophthalmic eyes, where you expect the intraocular pressure in the immediate posterior period, if it goes low, it will land with a lot of complications of supracortical hemorrhage, supracortical effusion, and complications of maculopathy and all that. So for first 1 or 2 weeks, you want that the pressure should not be very low. That's why you have passed more number of sutures on the table, and see that intentionally the pressure remains slightly on the high side. The moment you see that the wound healing is complete or it is reasonably so, you release it in 2 weeks' time. After 2 weeks, releasable suture has no role because it is already adhered. So but most of the cases you have titrated the wound on the table, I think you don't need any releasable suture. So, if you release the releasable sutures early, so nothing happens. But after 2 weeks, even to pull it with the adjustable suture, the flap is not going to be reflected. So practically, that doesn't have any value, provided you have titrated it on the table quite well, antechamber is well formed, and the pressure is within your acceptable limit, maybe 8 to 10. I think religious suture are a very, very limited value, except that in cases of high myopes, in vitrectomized eyes, in non-ophthalmic eyes, where you need the pressure, immediate post-operative pressure should not be low.
Right, sir. So, we